U external. However, U external in this case is given only by this force. Done? So the title of this lecture is exercise number one. It is the same exercise that we have given last time. This is the structure. We call beam 1 and 2 with this versus of the abscissa, x and y. The convention for the sign of the displacement is given only here. For a variational approach, you need to give a convention for the sign only of the displacement. If you use balance of force, you should also introduce a convention for the force and for moments. That is a little bit more complicated because force, contact force, has different sign if you consider the force of one part to the other or the vice versa. So you should have care, much more care in this case. But for a variational approach, since everything depends upon the displacement, you need only to give this convention. So this is the structure. Here you see that if the abscissa is in this direction, W, U, and theta is this versus. If the abscissa is given with this other versus, the convention gives you another interpretation of the displacement field. U and W change the sign, and theta is the same. The internal energy is given by the internal energy of the first beam plus the internal energy of the second beam. The external energy is given only by this force. But this force has an energy that is given by F, because here we find F, multiplication of the displacement in this direction. However, the displacement in this direction, what is it? If we have this convention, this is, of course, it is a transverse displacement, because the beam is a vertical and this is a force in the horizontal displacement. So, if this is your assumption, by the way, the versus of the abscissa is of course something that should be independent of the results, because it is something that you choose arbitrarily. One can choose everything. Of course, the physics cannot be changed by your assumption. I mean, it cannot be changed. Therefore, the physical results will be independent upon the convention. However, it is useful to introduce one convention, take every time this the same convention, and you will see that the physical results will be independent of this. So, one trick is, at least at the beginning, to do the exercise with one convention, with another convention, and arrive to a result that is independent of the convention chosen. Okay, the external energy is force, displacement. Displacement is in this direction. Okay, this is the abscissa, so you see that U is positive in this direction. So, the displacement on which this force make work is minus U in zero. Minus U in zero, which U? The U of the second beam. Okay? That means that here, instead of putting UX minus UX, you should put plus F U2 in zero. So this is your action for this exercise. You need to find a minimum of this functional a minimum of this functional among all admissible displacement fields. The admissible displacement fields are those displacement fields that satisfies this restriction. The restrictions are for this constraint is U1 in 0 is equal to W1 in 0 equal to theta 1 in 0 equal to 0. Okay, instead of using theta 1 in 0, it is sufficient to use U1 prime, because for this convention, moment, because for this convention, the assumption of the Euler beam is that U prime is equal to theta. In some books, you can find a different convention. Sometimes theta is positive in the other direction. For this reason, sometimes you find, for example, if you find a convention like this, of course, here you will see a minus sign. Of course. So it's not a mistake if you see in a book that U prime is minus theta. It depends upon the convention. Sometimes the convention is even not mentioned in the books, because who write the books have in mind live in a world inside their own convention, so they are. But of course, you are a reader, so you need to be careful on this. Okay, here are the restriction on U1. The restriction on U2 is that W1 in 0 is equal to W2 in 0, in this direction is 0, is equal to U2 prime in 0 equal to 0. And then you have to characterize the kinematical constraint here. And here what you say? You say that this constraint means, of course, here you, why you have not put the U in 0 equal to, U2 in 0 equal to 0? Because here we have this. Sometimes one say, instead of putting a force, one can say, okay, I put a displacement constraint. So instead of writing this, sometimes you can find in the book something like this. That means that you have you impose a displacement in this direction. Of course, you have to change the picture of the constraint. It's not anymore a roller, but it is a clamp. But in this case, if you do this, then, I mean, if you have this picture, you have to add here also another kinematical constraint, that is U2 in 0 equal to minus U bar. If you have this constraint, this is a kinematical constraint. A kinematical constraint means a constraint in the restriction on the kinematical fields. Therefore, I mean, also the problem is structurally different, because the number of constraints is different. If you have a constraint like this, you don't have this, and you don't have this. Therefore, the kinematical restrictions are less. you will see that the number of boundary conditions will be always the same, because you substitute a kinematical restriction with a dynamical restriction, with the dual of that restriction. These are static kinematic duality in mechanics. Yes? If you have this constraint, you don't have this part. You don't have. Because you don't have F. Here you don't have F. Moreover, if you do the variation of this functional will be F variation of this, but this is prescribed. So the variation of U in zero is zero. So it does not have any role with this. So anyway, we want to solve this problem, therefore we do not have this, we do not have this, and we do not have this. However, we need to add also other kinematical constraints. These kinematical constraints are continuity of the displacement. So, the continuity of the displacement is continuity. In principle, one can say, okay, the displacement d vector of beam 1 evaluated in x equal to L is equal to the displacement of the beam 2 evaluated in y equal to L. Okay? But this displacement is also given, because this is a vectorial displacement, and the other is theta 1 at x equal to L is equal to theta 2 at y equal to L. So you have the three boundary conditions, the three kinematical restrictions, this one and this one. Now we need to write this boundary condition in terms of the kinematical fields. That you know that this U depends on U W theta, U W theta of the first beam and of the second beam. But this is for Timoshenko. For Euler, this is even not important. It's not important. We forget a contribution in the internal energy due to the axial displacement. For axial displacement, you should add plus. We could add here kn over 2 w1 prime square, and here plus kn over 2 w prime 2 square. And of course, open, close, open, close. Okay? If you have the restriction of inextensibility, then kn go to infinity, w prime is zero. But here W prime is square, so it wins the zero of W prime, so this will not have any contribution. If you do this in the balance of force scheme, you do not have any notion of the energy, you have a notion of force, and then you have an indeterminate form, because you have the axial force is equal to kn w prime. So you have zero, infinite, this multiplication, with the same order. So you have that something finite is given by the product of zero and infinite. So you should be careful on this. So here, d1, what is it? D1 is equal to w1 in L. Let us assume that to write these vectors in this frame of reference. So this displacement has one component in this direction, and the other component is u1 at L, u2, e2. And this other is w2 at L, e1 or 2. So the axial component is positive in this direction. So this is parallel to E1 or E2. Here we want to write the displacement of the second beam at Y equal to L. So the displacement of the second beam of this point. W2 at L, with this convention, so it should rotate, so W2 is positive in upward, as a component directed towards E1 or towards E2? E2. And the other component is U2 at L, E1. Minus. Very good. Very good. And then, therefore, the restrictions are here is clear, because you can say that this is equal to this. So you should say that W1 at L is equal to minus U2 at L, and U1 at L is equal to W2 at L, and the restriction on this is given by U1 prime at L is equal to U2 prime at L. Because independently of the versus, the rotation always is positive in one sign, one verse. Therefore, this restriction is explored here, and this restriction is explored here. If we have this other constraint, let us assume to have this other constraint, the internal hinge, not the internal clamp, what does it change? The rotation, this restriction does not exist, therefore this restriction does not exist. Okay? Again, you change the kinematical constraints, you change the problem. So here I can erase. You can erase and you can simply have, okay, delta functional u, so we can say delta u, delta u is equal to delta this, so we have the integral from 0 to L of km u second 1 delta u 1 second plus kn w 1 prime delta w 1 prime plus the integral from 0 to L of the same things. But here you can use the same results of last time that can be derived in this way, because here you can say minus u third like this, and then plus km here we should do the calculation again, because otherwise so we have this with plus sign, okay? Then what we have that this is equal to, it is equal to km u second 1 delta u 1 prime derivative, integral of the derivative is between 0 and L minus this. With plus, okay? Sorry?
Another derivative of u.
And then another derivative. So we can say minus km u1 second delta u1 between 0 and L. This means that you have to evaluate the expression inside the bracket at L minus the expression inside the bracket at 0. And then another plus.
So the problem is that you didn't put the third derivative.
Here the third derivative, yeah. So
for the,
also here, yeah. Yes. Therefore, when you do this, you have to change again the sign. You have this fourth, and here you don't have. Okay. And of course, this you can change again. You can say plus kn w1 prime delta w1 between 0 and L, and here you have minus second and without this. And the same for the other. So these two equations means simply that the partial differential equations are very easy, because we do not have any distributed force. So you have that w 1 second equal to w 2 second equal to 0, and u 1 fourth equal to u 2 fourth equal to 0. These are the partial differential equation, because you can say that this should be equal to 0 for any admissible kinematical fields. Therefore, if this is arbitrary, this must be zero. So it means that U fourth is equal to zero. If this is arbitrary, this must be zero. So W second is equal to zero, and also for the other beam. So this can be changed, can be erased. And of course the same results for the beam 1 must be reproduced for the beam 2. So you have plus Km U2 second delta prime 1 from 0 to L 2 minus Km U2 third delta 2 from 0 to L plus Kn W prime 1 delta W 2 from 0 to L. Very simple. Now you have this restriction. And then, this delta U is delta of this two, but also delta of this. Therefore, you should add also plus F delta U. Delta U 2 at 0. Delta U 2 at 0, because you have this. So delta U is given only by this, if you consider these partial differential equations. So, what does it mean? It means that now, what you can say many things, because you can exploit now this form where I can, or say, therefore, this one can be changed, can be erased. This can be erased because now we need to take into account this external constraint, because you need to have that this variation is zero for any admissible kinematical fields. Therefore, delta U, what is it? For example, you have delta U2 prime delta U2 prime at L that multiply Km U2 second at L minus delta U2 prime at 0 Km U2 second at 0. And so this has been taken into account. However, you also have this. You have plus delta U1 prime at L. However, you can see from here that if you have this restriction, this kinematical restriction, for sure delta U1 prime is equal to delta U2 prime at L. If two fields are the same, also their variation is the same. Therefore, this is equal to this. Therefore, when you interpret this, you say Km, you say u 1 second delta 1 prime, but delta 1 prime is delta 2 prime. So delta 1 prime so therefore this is equal to we can say we can call this variation as variation of theta bar, for example, no? Therefore this variation is variation of theta bar. No? If we have this definition, this is variation of theta bar, but also here at L is variation of theta bar. Therefore here you should add plus K M U 1 second at L. And the other is minus delta U 1 at 0 prime Km U 1 second at 0. So we are taking into account this one, this addend and this addend. However, you see that delta 2 1 prime in 0 is 0. Is a restriction, there is a restriction for this. Therefore also the variation of delta u prime in 0 is 0. However, if the variation of delta u prime is 0, this can be erased. If this can be erased, we will erase this part. Huh? Moreover, you also have that this one. Huh? If u1 prime in 0 is 0, also delta u1 prime in 0 is 0. Therefore, also this one is 0. So this can be erased. So at the end, I mean, we need to evaluate also this other part. But you see that you have delta theta bar. What is the theta bar? Theta bar is the common rotation of these two beams that is arbitrary. So this is important because it is an internal constraint. It is an internal constraint. Therefore, it does not say that the rotation of this section is zero, nor that the variation of this section is zero. They say the constraints say simply that the variations are the same, but arbitrary. And this arbitrariness is given by the arbitrariness of this function. This variable that is arbitrary. Therefore, if we say that this one is zero for any variation of the kinematic fields, admissible kinematic fields, this is arbitrary and this must be zero. Okay? From a balance equation point of view, you see that you have the balance of moments, because maybe you have, you know that this is the moment of the second bar at L, and this is the bending moment of the first bar at L. The sign is already prescribed, because if you remember, for the balance of force and for the balance of moments, For example, if you use a convention for the moment like this, if this is the if in the balance of moments, in the balance of force approach, with this abscissa, you need to write also a convention for the axial force, for the shear force, and for the moment. Okay? And in particular, the moment is the moment. With this convention, it is possible to see that the moment is given by Km u second. But for the balance of force approach, you should say? You should say that this is the abscissa, therefore the moment that is acting here is given with this sign. So this is the moment of the first beam at L, and from down, what you say? This is the abscissa, so you should rotate this convention, and you see that you need to evaluate this sign. So you rotate, and the sign is here. So this is the moment of the second beam at L. And so you can say that if you need to have the balance of moments, you need to say this plus this equal to zero. Not the same, cannot be the same. In the balance of force approach, you see that the sum of the moments are zero. And you see the counterpart in the variational approach. Of course, if you say, okay, I add here another couple, like this, in the balance of moments, what do you have? You have that the sum of this is equal to m bar. For the variational approach, in fact, if you have something like this, you need to say that the external energy is the external energy of this added part will be equal to m u prime in L, for example, the first beam. Therefore, in U, this appear with the minus sign. Therefore, the variation of this is the variation of this. And therefore, this is will be equal to delta theta prime, and so you have this one minus M inside. So you have also the same for the variational approach. So, at the end, the results are the same for the balance of force approach and for the variational approach. The variational approach is considered better because it is easier to generalize. If you do research, it is better to use variational approach because the generalization is easier, at least. By the way, we have this term. Maybe we can translate this delta theta bar here. In our problem, there is no external couple, so here is not given. Okay, and we do not call anything about moment. And also, this convention is not important. Okay, and so also these pictures are not important. And we can go on, because we need to extrapolate this. So now we can say, here we had a minus, here. That means that you have minus Km u to third at L, delta u2 at L, delta u2 at L, plus delta U2 at zero, because minus, but then this is downstairs, so minus minus, or plus delta U2 at zero, Km U2 at zero. And so we have considered this. Then we can consider also, so here everything is coupled, so we should say, for example, this one is where we can write there, so here you can say plus delta W2 et L multiplication of Kn delta Kn W 1, 2 e 0. No, et L, sorry. Plus sign. And the same with minus sign. So minus delta W 2 e 0 multiplication of Kn W prime 2 e 0. So this one with the plus sign and this one with minus sign. However, what we know? We know that, for example, delta W2, so W2 et L, where is it? W2 et L is equal to U1 et L. U1 et L we do not have already written. So the only consideration that we can say, that we can do now, is that, for example, no, it's simply that W2 at 0 is equal to 0. Therefore, also the variation of W2 in 0 is equal to 0. Therefore, this term can be cancelled. And so we will cancel, because we need some space. Yeah?
In the second line, it should be W third.
Here? Third. One, two, and three. Correct. So, we have inserted this, and we have inserted this. Now we need to insert this, and to insert this we can say minus minus delta 1, so we can insert for example here, so minus maybe here minus Km, no, minus delta U1 et L, delta U1 et L multiplication of Km U1 third 1, 2, 3 et L, then plus delta U1 et 0, delta U1 et 0 Km U third 1 at 0. However, U1 at 0 is 0. Therefore, the variation of U1 at 0 is 0, and therefore this can be cancelled. We have insert this, we need to insert now this, and we can say that we can do plus delta W 1 et L multiplication of Kn W1 prime et L with the plus sign. Then we have minus delta W1 multiplication of Kn W prime 1 at 0. This also in 0. In 0. And so we have insert this. And we need now to put F delta 2. So simply we can say plus F delta U2 in 0. And so we have insert also this part. Therefore the variation of delta U now is already is written everything upstairs. So this can be cancelled. Okay? You see that in this reasoning I've done everything like a computer, a machine. In fact, if you use console, there is some lecture, someone has given to you some lectures. This can be, a software can do everything alone, because there is nothing to think about this. These derivations are automatically. Now I do at the blackboard in order to let you know that it is possible to do by hand, but it is automatic. So now we should say that, thank you, now we should analyze, thank you, we should analyze, we should say, okay, delta U2 at L is compatible, you see, delta U2 at L is comparable with W1 at L. Because if this constraint is correct, also, if this constraint is correct, means that delta W1 at L is equal to minus delta U2 at L. If we call this delta W bar, for example, like theta bar is the rotation, the free rotation of this point, delta W bar can be the free translation of this point in this direction. That means that delta U2, you see that here we can say plus, and this is delta W bar, and delta W1 at L, where is it? Delta W1 at L is here, okay? So instead of putting delta W1 at L, we can put delta W. Therefore, we can say that delta W bar multiplication of Km U third 2 at L with plus sign, and here always with plus sign, plus Kn W 1 prime at L. Close. And what is it? So that means that if we insert this expression, means that this can be cancelled and this can be cancelled. This is arbitrary. That means that everything inside here is another boundary condition that corresponds in the balance of force approach to the balance of force of this part in the horizontal direction, because W bar is the free displacement in this direction. The sign in the balance of force approach, you should take care on all the signs with the action, with the contact action, and for variational approach is already there. And another consideration, so we have another consideration is given by because now we have these two, okay? This means that delta U1 at L is equal to delta W2 at L. We call this delta U bar, and this is the common variation of the displacement in the vertical direction, and this means that the delta W2 at L is given by delta U bar. So this is delta U bar. Delta U1 at L is given by delta U bar. Therefore, you should have delta U bar multiplication of this term, so Kn W prime 2 at L minus Km U third 1 at L. So the three extra boundary condition from the variational approach is given by these two and by this one. And of course this term we have already taken into account. And also this term we have already taken into account. You see that these two are connected. We can call, for example, delta, okay, we can see simply. Now we can say plus delta U2 at zero multiplication of Km U third 2 at zero plus F. We have inserted this and this that can be cancelled now. And so you have the kinematic bond, the dual, I mean, this is arbitrary because there is no restriction on this displacement. Therefore, the variation is arbitrary. Therefore, since we need to have this condition for any arbitrary and admissible kinematical fields, this is arbitrary. And because it is admissible to have a displacement in that direction, therefore you have an extra boundary condition. And so you have this boundary condition, and stop. So, your kinematic boundary condition are here, we have already written, this one, these are the kinematic boundary condition, this one, this one, this ones, and this one. The dynamic boundary condition, the blue one, are, since this is arbitrary, you need to say that this is zero. You need to say that this is zero. This is zero and this is zero. So how many we have? We have 1, 2, 3, 4. No, this is not. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Please.
This tree constraint is not dependent. Actually,
Sorry. This constraint. Which one? This one.
All of them. That in the contact point you wrote this equation are not independent. Actually, the blue ones are result of this.
Yes.
So these are not independent.
Very good question. They are independent because. These are very good questions because it seems okay. The question is very well conceived because he says these are our kinematical boundary conditions, our kinematical constraints. From these kinematical constraints, we derive 1, 2, and 3 boundary conditions. However, you see that they are different boundary conditions, first of all. Second, you add you are considering this constraint, this principle. So you have kinematical boundary condition and this principle, and this principle gives you this extra boundary condition.
Yes.
So at the end, this constraint gives you not only these three boundary conditions, but also these other three boundary conditions. So at the end, these constraints gives you 6 boundary conditions.
But when I wrote, when I solved this problem, just I used these three.
Just these three?
No. The blue
one. Only the blue ones, without the red one. It's impossible. You cannot find a solution without assuming, because I mean, this no, can be as.
Excuse me. I mean, I drive them. Next, I drive them, but in solving, I just used the blue ones.
No. Probably you have used also this one. Yeah, for sure. Now we will see. We will see directly. But just to say that these constraints gives you 6 boundary conditions. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. These constraints gives you 3 boundary conditions. That is 1, 2. The kinematic one, the two from here, and the dynamic one is here. So 3, and this one, 3 boundary condition, this is very trivial, where they are here, these 3. So at the end, for each beam, you have 6 boundary condition, 3 on one side and 3 on the other side. If on one constraint you have 2 beams, there you have 6 boundary conditions, 3 from one, 3 from the other. But even though these boundary conditions are coupled, so they are not, you see from here, you have U2 and W1, so everything is coupled. And the order of the partial differential equation for each beam is of 6th order. So everything is coherent with the fact that the variational approach gives you directly a unique solution for at least for this linear problem. So you have a 6th order equation for this beam, 6 order equation from this beam, so you have 12 order differential equation. Why 12? 2 plus 2, 4, plus 4, 8, plus 4, 12, and 12 boundary condition, 3 plus 6 plus 3, okay? And here you have the representation. To see from a practical point of view, in order to solve this, you can simply say, okay, if you have that W1 second is 0, it means that you can integrate one time here and then another time. If you integrate one time, it means that W1 prime is equal to a constant, because the integral of 0 is a constant. Let us call this constant, for example, W1 0, and therefore W1 is equal to the integral of this. That means, W1 1. So W1 1 x plus another constant, that is W1 0. So the two constants are here. Okay? So you integrate two times this differential equation, two times this differential equation, four times this differential equation, and four times this differential equation. Since you integrate in an indefinite way, how many constants you have? One constant for every integration. So you have 12 constants. So now you have 12 constants to understand. To calculate, and how many equations you need to derive, to calculate 12 constant linear equation? 12. So for this reason I tell you it is impossible that you use only this and not this where is it? There. Because you have 12 constants and you need 12 equations. And now it is very easy, because once you have this, for example, W1, where is it? For example, here, W1 in 0 is equal to 0. It means that W1 in 0 is equal to 0, but W1 in 0 is here. Therefore, this constant is 0 directly. A computer do not do this calculation. Simply, he has a matrix, 12 by 12 matrix, constant, 12, the 12 constants given by the integration, equal to another column. Solving by Cramer, and you get the results. So very easy from of course the larger are the number of these constants, the heavier is the computational cost. If you have 1,000 beam, then you have to invert a matrix 1,000 by 1,000. This is the reason why it's very important, if you do a numerical code, a numerical course, having a numerical trick to invert the matrix is very important also from mechanics, because this calculation is done. Maybe in the next presentation with Emilio, what you can say? Okay, from the homework you can say from this calculation, you will see directly the function of the displacement fields of the first beam and of the second beam. Okay? You will arrive directly, because you have 12 equations, 12 unknowns, and you solve the problem. Once you have the unknowns, that now are knowns, not anymore unknowns. Now, then you add the displacement field for every point. For example, the displacement field here, how much is it?
Zero,
for sure, because you have imposed. Here, maybe not, or maybe yes, because the force here is only horizontal, so probably this beam remains fixed. Probably this beam... No, because this force means also a couple here, so maybe this also... It depends upon... I mean... Then once you have the solution, you can play, because you can say, let us assume inextensibility. Inextensibility means that Kn is infinite. So in your solution, you put Kn to infinite. What does it mean? You have inextensibility. It means that this bar do not extend. That means that this bar cannot deflect, because you have a restriction here. Cannot reflect. Cannot be translate in this way. Cannot translate in this way. So probably this bar will be fixed in the inextensible case. In civil engineering, every time this assumption is given, but it's not true. For example, if you have a beam made of rubber or a bone, it's not true. So take care on this. So take care. So you can say, you can play with the inextensibility and non-inextensibility with this simple problem. Another problem that you will find with Emilio is to find, for example, a numerical solution for this with finite element. With finite element method, you can arrive to a numerical solution. Of course, you have to with the finite element, you have to say the numbers, the correct, the reasonable numbers for the constitutive for the constitutive constants Km and Kn, and for the force, and for the length of the beams. And another thing that you can solve is the following. That is good for those people that may want to do a fracture internship, so a thesis on fracture. Because you know that in elastic beam, you load the structure, then you remove the load, and the beam remains the same. Not all the time this is true, because you load the structure, then if your load is too much, there is something inside the structure that is broken. So you remove the structure, and maybe sometimes the configuration remains the same, go back to the same position. However, the internal structure is changed, and in this case, you are dealing with damage mechanics. Sometimes the configuration is changed. The stress-free reference configuration, so the reconfiguration after the removal of the loading, is not anymore the same as the first one, and in this case you have also plastic effect. What you can do with Emilio is a project on the first stage, that is more simple, so a damage mechanic process. So you can say, okay, this is F, this is the force, and you can say, where is the point of the structure that is damaged? How much it is damaged, these points? Maybe you will have a damage here, 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 and so on. But maybe this point is more damaged than that point. And so, because maybe for engineering it's important to know where is the section of the structure that must be reinforced more than the other. So you need to know with that load where are the sections that are more damaged. So for maybe your kinematic is here, the internal energy with you remember it depends upon the displacement and the rotation, no, maybe only the displacement of the first beam and of the second beam. In this case, the result will be important also for the damage field of the first beam and of the second beam. Let us call omega 1 and omega 2 the damage field of the first and of the second beam. What is the problem? The problem is that when you are dealing with damage, the situation is not anymore reversible. So you are losing some energy. So a variational approach must be generalized. So I have given to some of you some papers on which we have done some work on the generalization of variational approach to the damage mechanics. There are millions of papers on this fields, and we have used one approach, and you can study this approach and make this simple application on beams. The time for this internship will not be so large that you can understand everything, but you can see the results and make maybe a numerical simulation for these results. Okay.